joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Laughed it on the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing ye islands of the sea. Echo back ye ocean caves. Earth shall keep her jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free. Highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Amen.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. For me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. And we are his portion. He is our prize. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. His grace is an ocean we're all sinking. Heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss. My heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to entertain these regrets. I think about the way. How he loves us so. Oh, how how he loves us
all.
Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Yeah,
he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Amen. Thank you, Isabella. Take your Bible to Genesis, the 18th chapter. Genesis, the 18th chapter. I don't know if you know this or not, because if somebody were to walk up to you and say, have you ever witnessed a miracle, you might, other than salvation, which I pray we've all been witness to, you might say no. Well, this morning, as we were closing the service here, I found out after the service that Bonnie had to wrap hers up because I quit before she did. And so you mark it down, February the 17th, 2019. I was there when it happened. Never thought I'd see it, but there it was. There it was. Genesis, the 18th chapter. Good to see you. And I mentioned to you, I found out just a few minutes ago that Barbara Bailey is back in the hospital today. And not exactly sure what's going on, but I'll check on her after the service is over. So remember her. And Genesis, the 18th chapter. Reading through the chapter, if we get to it all. But one thing that we all know is rarely in life do we get to wear the proverbial one hat. Everybody has to wear several hats. You think about just the obvious things in life, and I would just speak for me. I'm a husband, I'm a father, I'm a grandfather, I'm a son, I'm a brother, I'm a pastor, and the list could go on. And so it would be for all of us. We all have several hats to wear and several sides to us. Well, tonight we pick back up in the story of Abraham as we've been sort of following through here the last several weeks. And Abraham he finds himself in this personal encounter with the Lord. And in this encounter, if we look at it, if we just read through it and not looking for something, we might miss it. But if we'll look for it, we will find in this passage of Scripture, we'll find three different sides to this man named Abraham or called Abraham. So as we go through, we're going to try to uncover those, and I will mention them to you, and you can note them on your outline if you don't have one. There's some bulletins in the foyer if you'd like to grab one to follow along. If you don't have it, but we're just going to read the passage as we get to it to keep us from reading so much at the very beginning. But in the first, this part will cover the first six verses. We will find the ministry of a servant. Now we know that Abram, as he's been called up until a week or so ago, and we got to where his name changed, but he's been told that he's going to be the father of many nations. He's going to be the father of many. He hadn't become the father of one up until the one that wasn't supposed to happen, and Ishmael come along, but he still hasn't received the son of promise. But here he is, and we have Abraham lined up here, and we find him in the ministry of a servant. Now, when we begin our reading of this passage of Scripture, It just begins by telling us, it says, then the Lord appeared to him. That little him, that's Abraham. Now, when it says the Lord appeared, we have to look at the word Lord, and it's capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. And we know that when it's fully capitalized, that it's talking about Jehovah. Jehovah of the Old Testament is Jesus of the New Testament. Now, being that that's true, and you say, well, Jesus hadn't come along until the New Testament, but if you look and you go back and you study, you find that there are several occasions where Jesus does appear in the Old Testament. In fact, we know that Jesus always was. There come a time for his birth, and that come along, and we read that in the Gospels. But here we have an appearance of the Lord Jesus himself, and the other two that are a part of this visit with Abraham as a servant are two angels. They're just ordinary, what I guess we can call them ordinary angels, if there are ordinary angels, but they're two ordinary angels. Now, we could say that Abraham quickly recognizes who's there. I don't have any doubt that he would probably recognize the Lord, but the two angels, I don't know if he recognized or not that they were heavenly visitors there, but here's what Abraham does, is Abraham springs into action. Now, that's becoming, as we go in our culture today, that's becoming more and more unrecognizable. You go into a restaurant, sometimes it's hard to get service. You go into a store, sometimes it's hard to get somebody to, unless you don't want them to wait on you, and then they pester you to death, and if you do want them to wait on you, they're as far away as the Sahara Desert, and that's kind of the way it goes, at least it is with me. Well, Abraham, he just springs into action. And we learn some things from this. And in fact, let's read the first six verses and we will note the quickness of the ministry of Abraham. It says, then the Lord appeared to him by the terebinth trees of Mamre, and he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day. So he lifted his eyes and looked and beheld three men standing by him. And when he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the ground and said, my Lord, if I have now found favor in your sight, do not pass on by your servant. Please let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree, and I will bring a morsel of bread and you may refresh your hearts. After that, you may pass by inasmuch as you have come to your servant. They said, do as you have said. So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah and said, quickly make ready three measures of fine meal, knead it, and make cakes. Now, here's what he does, is he springs into action. What does he spring into action for? It's not a high-profile job. It's not a job that he's going to get written up in the newspaper about. It's none of those things. But he just springs into action to meet the needs of the people that are visiting him. And he does it quickly. Now we sit around and we think about, well, what do we want in a leader? What do we want in somebody that's going to be our leader? And listen, there's nothing wrong with qualification. There's nothing wrong with any of those things. But I'm going to tell you one of the things that I was, here I am at 56 years old now, and if I were going to look for somebody that was just sort of going to be a natural leader, I would look for somebody out of a group of people, not because they had a piece of paper that said they graduated from such and such of a school and have such and such of a degree, but somebody that would just, in a group of people in a particular setting, that they could be in that setting and they could see something that needed to be done, and without anything being said to that individual, they would just get up and do it. And that's what Abraham does. Now, one of the things we've learned about Abraham over the past months is we have learned that he is very, very, very the W word, or the R word, rich. He's very wealthy. And being that he is very wealthy, we know that he has many what? He has many servants. So being in his position, being that he is going to be the father of many nations, and he is the master of many servants, He was in a position that he could have turned around and said, hey, servant number 27, servant number 222, go and do this for these people. But is that what he did? No. He saw a need, and he got up and he met the need, and he did it quickly. Nobody had to point out, this needs to be done. Nobody had to say, you need to go do this. Nobody had to say, Abraham, we have guests, you need to go take care of. Nobody said any of those things. He just knew that he was in the presence of the Lord and these two angels, if he knew who they were, and he saw that there was a need, and he quickly moved. He goes into the tent, and he tells Sarah to begin to prepare because they're going to make a meal for these. But Abraham is the one that springs into action. He's the one that pops up there. You say, well, what does this mean for us? It brings two verses of Scripture to my mind. One comes out of Colossians 3 and 23, and here's what the Bible says. You ready for this? Whatever you do, do it heartily. Whatever you do, do it heartily, as unto the Lord, not to men. And then the Bible says in Ephesians 6:6, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bond servants of Christ, doing the will of God from guess where? The heart. From the heart. Listen, if something is worth doing for the Lord, it is worth doing right. And it is worth doing with zest. People all the time, and listen, I'm not going to tell you I've never been guilty of this, but people all the time, we drag ourselves to church. We drag ourselves to this and we drag ourselves to that. Listen, if something is worth doing for the Lord, it is worth doing heartily. It doesn't matter what our job is, if it's taking up the offering, if it's cleaning the bathroom, if it's doing whatever it is to be doing according to the Word of God, not the Word of Steve. If you're doing it for the Lord, do it heartily. Do it heartily, and that's what Abraham does. It's the quickness of his ministry. Then in verse 7 and 8, we find the quality of his ministry. I forgot my blown up, so I'm having to focus here on the real Bible, and it's real hard. In verse 7, it says, and Abraham ran to the herd. He took a tender and good calf and gave it to a young man and hastened to prepare it. So he took butter and milk and the calf which he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. Not only was Abraham quick, not only was he swift in his service to the Lord, he was sacrificial in his service. He's sacrificial in his service to the Lord. Abraham went to his flock. He didn't send somebody. He went. He went to his flock. He selected one of his flock. He either killed or had killed one of his flock. He prepared this for the meal. And listen, when you become a servant, when you become one who is going to lead, and you really haven't become a servant, we can say we are, but until our service has cost us something personally, we really hadn't become a servant. When we become a servant to the Lord, when we become a servant to others and we're willing to sacrifice, that means that we have sacrificed some things. Maybe we've sacrificed time. Maybe we've sacrificed financially. Maybe we've sacrificed effort. Maybe we've sacrificed from something that we could have or wanted to be doing, but rather this ministry opportunity come along and we did this, so we did that, and that's what Abraham does. That's what Abraham does. He does this work and he gives sacrificially of his effort and all of these things. And you know, when God, we think about all the things God wants from us. Money, you know, our tithes and our offerings and this, that, and the other. What he wants more than any of that is he just wants you. Because when he has you, he has all the rest. And God had Abraham. God had him. And here he is in this place, and his ministry has great quality to it. Then in the eighth verse, we already read it, won't reread it. We also find of the quietness of his ministry. While the three guests, the Lord and the two angels, while the visitors were eating their meal, what does Scripture tell us that Abraham did? He just stood quietly. He struck a pose, if you would, the pose of a servant, one who was the master of probably thousands of servants. But he struck the pose of a servant, waiting to hear whether or not any of these were going to have a need that he might be able to meet in the meantime. That's what Abraham did. He wasn't making conversation. He wasn't doing any of these things. He was just standing by quietly to serve them, to see if there was going to be a need that he might meet in their life. So he stands there listening for the voice of need to come up. Now you think, well, what difference does that make? Can just imagine this with me. Can you imagine what Abraham's servants were thinking when they looked in on this scene and they seen their master being a servant to his master? I think it made a very indelible impression on their life. Now, let me tell you this, and I'll get the bus out of here, and we'll move it on down the road. None of us. And you remember when Paul was talking about sinners, and he said, I'm the chief? Remember that? None of us put me at the top of the list. None of us are too good to be a servant. When we get to the place in our life where we think we're too good to be a servant, we're not much good in any way, shape, form, or fashion. I believe that Abraham is a great leader because Abraham knows how to be a good servant. And when you know how to be a good servant, you have the possibility of being a good leader. If you never get the servant part down, you're never going to get the leader part down. But he had the servant part down. Where he learned it, not sure. But he learned it somewhere. Somebody, his daddy, the Spirit of God, the Word of God. I don't know where he learned it. But somebody taught him to be willing to serve. And he did. He did. So we learn of the ministry. That's the first side of Abraham. The second side is the message for a saint. Now, This goes from verse 9 all the way down through verse 21. So we'll break it up and kind of read it. But here's what we find in this particular part of the passage is that God always rewards faithful service. People don't always recognize it. People don't always notice. In fact, people get mad sometimes. Somebody will do something or will do something and then we'll walk away, well, nobody recognized what I did. Listen to me. It doesn't make a hill of beans if anybody recognizes what you did. God always rewards faithful service. If you're doing it, in fact, the Bible tells us, if we're doing it for the applause and the acclaim of man, when they get through doing this, that's it. It's over. But if we're doing it for the honor and the glory of God, man may never notice, but he does. And God always rewards faithful service that is rendered to and for him. So in Abraham's case, he recognizes this and he rewards this faithful service by reassuring him regarding the birth of Isaac that's yet to happen, but it's going to happen. And he tells us that again. He tells us of verse 18 and verse 19 that we'll read in a moment, tells us of the great affection. It tells us of the knowledge and the care that God possessed for his servant, for this man, Abraham. And listen, God knows the caliber of man that Abraham was, and he knew that Abraham was going to stand the test. He knew that Abraham was going to be everything that God wanted him to be, and he's pictured that way as the saint of God. So there's a message about a child, beginning with verse 9, read through verse 15. Then they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" So Abraham, or so he said, "Here in the tent." And he said, "I will certainly return to you according to the time of your life, and behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son." Now Sarah was listening in the tent, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in age, and Sarah being past the age of childbearing, therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, "After I have grown old, shall I have the pleasure, and this is small case letters here, my Lord, being old also." So she's referring to Abraham. "And the Lord," capitals, "said to Abraham," why did Sarah laugh? Now, he's not looking for information, because he's still the Omni, okay? So he's not looking for Abraham to tell him something that he don't know. But he asks the question, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I surely bear a child since I'm old?" And then he said this. He said, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" And then he said, "At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied it, saying, "I did not laugh, for she was afraid." And he said, "No, but you did laugh." So God had given this promise repeatedly, okay, that Abraham was going to have this promised son, and he had given this all of these times. The last time we read about it was in the 17th chapter, and I think it was in the 17th verse, and Abraham laughed. But Abraham's laugh, we believe, was not out of doubt, but it was out of joy. He laughed because he was joyous about this. So when he hears this, he hears this promise again. But this time, what happens is this promise is not repeated so that Abraham will not forget it. This time this promise is given for the benefit of Sarah. Because up until now, Sarah has only gotten the promise secondhand. Abraham would get the promise from God. He would go home. He would say, "Sarah, we're going to have a son. We're going to have a baby." So every time she got this news, it was what we would call secondhand information or secondhand promises. But this time, she hears it from the phrase we use sometimes is from the horse's mouth. She hears it this time from the mouth of God, and her reaction is vastly different than Abraham's reaction. Abraham's reaction was we believe it to be joy. She laughs because it's from doubt, and she is confronted about it, and she is rebuked for it. And this episode just reminds us again that God knows everything. God knows absolutely everything that there is to know about you and me. He knows our motives. He knows our secret sins. He knows everything that we do. And the Bible tells us, and I'm not going to read it, but in Hebrews, the 4th chapter and the 13th verse, the Scripture tells us that there is nothing hidden from the eyes of God. Nothing. So there's the message about a child in the first 6 verses there. Then beginning in verse 16, down through verse 21, there's a message about a city. It's the beginning there, and this is more familiar part of the story. It says, "Then the men rose from there and looked towards Sodom, and Abraham went with them to send them on the way. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing, since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I have known him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him. And the Lord said, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grave, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry against it that has come to me, and if not, I will know. Now, this is a point in Abraham's relationship with the Lord because of who he is. Now because of who Abraham is, he wants to conduct himself is to conduct himself, and also the future he's to enjoy. Now, God is determined. Now, this is a wonderful thought here. God is determined to share his heart with Abraham. He's determined. Listen, imagine being in a position of being so close to the Lord that the Lord is motivated to share his heart with you. Now, that begins to shed some light on why the Jews oftentimes refer to Abraham as the friend of God. Several times in Scripture. James 2:23, Scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Isaiah 41 and the 8th verse, but you, Israel, are my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the descendants of Abraham, my friend. Exodus 33:11, so the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend. And he would return to the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. So God, remember, he's the same then, now, and forevermore. And listen, he wants to have that close of a relationship with you and I. God wants to share some things with us. He wants to have an intimate relationship with us. And listen, when we're in the position, and that message this morning, to be cleansed and clean and pure before God, that puts us in a position where we're more ready and closer to the place where he can really share his heart with us and share his will with us. So he had the message for a saint, message about a child, message about a city. Then the third thing, the third side to Abraham, is the meditation of a son. The meditation of a son. Here's verse 22 and 23. Then the men turned away from there and went towards Sodom, but Abraham still stood before the Lord. And Abraham came near and said, he's talking to the Lord, would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Now, the message that the Lord had shared with Abraham, it was, have you ever heard a message from the Bible, message from the Lord that was just difficult to hear? I have. And listen, it had revealed to Abraham that his kinsmen, who of Abraham's kinsmen are over in Sodom? Lot is. And Lot is Abraham's nephew. So he is reminded here that Lot and Lot's family, they're in danger. They're in danger of death, and they're in danger of destruction. The cry of that place that is spoken of, and the grievous sin that is spoken of there, that's the reason for the destruction that is going to come. To many people, Sodom must have been viewed in the world's eyes as a show place, as a success story. because that's where Lot's eyes were drawn to. If you remember when he and Abraham got ready to part ways, he was drawn there. And if we would have just gone and asked the world, they would have said, "Oh, it's a neat place." Well, that's the way that they viewed it. They probably bragged about how it had been rebuilt after the great war that we talked about several chapters ago, back in about the 13th or 14th. But Abraham, he knew different. Abraham knew different, and he knew that the city, because of this information, because God had shared his heart with Abraham, Abraham now knows the destruction that is slated for Sodom. Now, for those of us who know a bit about the Bible, we know that our world today thinks pretty highly of itself. And we also know, according to the Word of God, we know the destruction that this world is headed for and the judgment that this world is headed for, but because of the judgment of God. Well. Here's the meditation of the Son and two things that we note about it. First of all, we note first the distance between them. Now, Scripture tells us in the two verses we read, 22 and 23, that Abraham stood before the Lord. And when the angels departed, Scripture told us or infers to us that he drew near. He may have been near to start with, but here he draws nearer. And aren't you glad today? And listen, I know that the Lord he's on his throne in heaven. He indwells us with the presence of his blessed Holy Spirit. But aren't you glad tonight that as God's children that we can approach him? Aren't you glad the Word of God tells us a bunch of, I won't call you a nobody, but I'll call me a nobody. And he says to a nobody like me, "Steve, you can approach the throne of God. You can come before the throne, and you can draw near to the Heavenly Father." And this invitation is given to us several times in Scripture. Once in Matthew 11 and 28, where Scripture says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest." Hebrews 4:15 and then 16. "We do not have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." Here's the 16th verse. "Let us therefore do what? Come boldly before the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." Listen, there's that we tonight. We can do one of two things. We're probably all saved. I hope we are. And if you're not, I hope you'll be saved tonight. But we can do one of two things. We can either sit here and we can say, "Well, I'm here on Sunday evening. Ain't I but about 50, 60, or whatever of us that they are, 70 of us here, and I must be closer to God than most people." And we can go home tonight satisfied that we're closer in our minds, that we're closer to God than most people. Or we can say, "Here's where I am with God, but I want to get closer. I want to get closer." Now, I can't answer that question for you. I couldn't answer that question for my children if they were sitting in this room. I can only answer that question for me. And I pray that my answer, not just because I'm standing on this platform, but because it is a desire of my heart, is that I, Steve Coward, a husband, a father, a dad, a granddad, a pastor, and whatever other sides there are and what other hats that I wear, I hope that the desire of my heart would be that I could get even closer to him than I've been in the past. So there's the distance between them. And then he carries this out, and I'm not going to read this part. You can read it on your own, but from verse 24 down through the 33rd verse here at the end of this 18th chapter, they begin to have dialogue. And you know what that dialogue is about if you've kind of scanned over it, but But Abraham's prayer that he prays in this in that section of scripture from the 24th verse down through the end, it comes out of some burdens that he carries. Some burdens because of the revelation that he has received. He's concerned about God's reputation from in what we read. If the Lord simply destroys the people of Sodom out of hand, then Abraham is concerned that people will get the wrong impression about God. So he's that's a concern about him, and he's also thinking about obviously Lot and his family. That's on Abraham's heart because Lot and his family live in Sodom, and Abraham wants to see them spared. In fact, that's a part of his prayer. So he begins to talk to God about this situation, and you know the haggling that goes on is almost like a used car salesman, if you would. If it get, can I get it for 10? Can I get it for this? Can I get it for that? And he goes on and on and on. And so he does this, and he gets God to go along and to agree. And you know how that story plays out. Well, the scripture tells us that when that night passed and when the morning came, that old Abraham looked towards Sodom. He looked in the direction of Sodom, and what did he see? He's seen smoke rising. He's seen smoke coming from the city, and what do you think filled his heart initially? I'll tell you what I would think. Discouragement. Because I have a feeling that Abraham may well have thought that, well, God got him. Including Lot and his family. But here's what Scripture says in just a couple of those verses. Drop to the 27th verse. It says, Abraham went early in the morning to the place where he had stood before the Lord. Then he looked toward Sodom and toward all the land of the plain, and he saw and behold the smoke of the land which went up like the smoke of a furnace. Even though he didn't realize, have you ever prayed before and as you were praying and the results that you could see initially, you thought, well, God didn't answer that prayer. You ever done that? Me and Lane have. I believe that when Abraham looked and he saw that smoke coming, he just began to maybe think that his prayer had been heard and it might not have been successful. But it had been heard, and it was successful. In the 29th verse of that passage of Scripture in the 19th chapter, it says, and it came to pass, when God destroyed the cities of the plain, mark this in your Bible, that God remembered Abraham, and he sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow, when he, God, overthrew the cities in which Lot had dwelt. Now, I know this is true. I know it's true for me, that sometimes it seems that our prayers are very weak. Sometimes it seems like our prayers are very ineffective. Sometimes it seems, and I'll be honest here, sometimes I wonder if my prayers got above the ceiling just over my head. And I sort of have a feeling that initially Abraham wondered, well, that one didn't go so well. But lo and behold, it did. It did go well. And God did spare Lot. And even when our prayers seem weak and ineffective, and listen, sometimes we won't know the benefit of our prayers down here in this world. I'm not going to ask for a response, but just run this through your mind. My daddy's mama, she died when I was 17. I was a senior in high school. And I just wonder, how many things that I was saved the year that she died. I was saved in October, and she passed away in December. She had Alzheimer's leading up to that, so She didn't know much for the last couple of years that she lived. She didn't know me from her brother or anybody else. But I wonder through the course of my life that followed, because she was a godly woman, I wonder how many things that she prayed for, she never saw them, but God was still faithful to them. She never told me this, but I don't have any doubt that there was three of us grandsons. Dad had me, his sister had one son, and his brother had one son. So there's three of us boys. And be quite honest, most of the time when we were together, we were holy terrors. So I just have a feeling that she probably prayed something. She was one of those women that when we'd go to bed at night, she would get up after we had gone to bed, and she'd get the 22 and go through the yard. And I think she slept in a slip is what I think she slept in. I don't know why, but it's what it looked like. But she would get up, and she'd go outside with a flashlight and a 22 and look for armadillos out, and they had 2 or 3 acres, and she'd walk over that land. You'd hear that gun go. She'd get her one. And I don't have any doubt that she prayed, God, you do something with them boys. You save them and make something out of them. And she didn't live long enough to see it. I'm telling you, God was faithful. And sometimes I know that we pray prayers, and listen, sometimes we pray them so long that sometimes we almost get tired of praying them, because it seems like that God is not acting on our prayers, and he's not meeting our the needs in our life. But listen, don't give up. You keep praying, because only eternity is going to hold to how God is going to work and move. You may be praying for grandchildren that you won't live long enough to know whether or not they come to know Jesus Christ, but you pray anyway. There's three sides to God's man, Abraham. And there's many sides to us. I pray tonight that every side of us that shows up, that we don't do anything for our glory, but that we do everything for the honor and the glory of our God. And God will honor that. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the people who have come in our lives and have been faithful to pray for us. And thank you for hearing their prayers, and even today, after many of those have passed, that you're still answering those prayers of even those that have departed. God, I pray tonight that as you look down upon us, and you see the many different places that you have placed us in life, and the many different places and the roles that we fill in our life, and God, I just pray that in every one of those, we do it heartily, as if we're doing it for Jesus Christ Himself. Lord, if we see somebody even tonight, before we could get home, and we have the opportunity and we have the means of offering them help, that we would do that as though it were Jesus Himself. And I pray that we would do it quickly without delay, and we would do it heartily because of our love and our obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we've mentioned this prayer list tonight and this morning. So we know, just out of our own little old church family, there are people that they need our prayers. Some of them need our presence. Some of them just need things that you've gifted us to be able to do. So let us be like old Abraham. And when we see a need, let us spring to action and do those things for the honor and the glory of our God in heaven. Speak to our heart in this invitation. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.